Good morning. My name is Lou Ann Bynum, and I'm the interim superintendent president at Long Beach City College. It's an honor for me to be here and to serve all of you. I want to welcome you to our virtual town hall meeting, especially designed for students. I know these past few weeks have been really, really difficult, and they're certainly unprecedented for us at the college. It's been very challenging for you, I'm sure, in your educational efforts, as well as in your personal lives at home. That's why we're all very thankful that you made time today to join us, so we can hopefully cover some topics and answer some questions that you're concerned about to give you some relief from some of these worries. We have two of our vice presidents here today, Dr. Kathy Scott and Dr. Mike Munoz. They'll be answering the questions, and I'm sure you have many of them, so we'll turn to them in just a few moments. But first, it's a real pleasure for me to be able to introduce our board president, Vivian Malauulu. She has been the first Latina elected to the board here at Long Beach City College in the history of the college. She represents Area 2, which is all of the West Side and parts of South Central Long Beach. She also is an educator herself, having taught for 20 years, and in fact, was a teacher, an adjunct teacher here in journalism at Long Beach City College. Please join me in welcoming President Malauulu.
Thank you, Superintendent President Lou Ann Bynum. Thank you for everyone tuning in at home, especially our students. We're so excited that you have joined us at the Student Town Hall. I'd like to welcome all of you. And I'd also like to thank those on the panel here with us today, Executive Vice President, Dr. Kathy Scott, Vice President of Student Services, Dr. Mike Munoz, and all of the other staff members who are here to assure you and ensure that you have a successful town hall that is informative. Just, you know, I don't know about you, but I haven't decided yet if this is the longest semester or the shortest semester. The jury is still out on that one. We've been through a lot this past semester with the last couple of weeks, and I just personally want to thank each and every one of you students. You know, you've all really done a terrific job transitioning to remote learning, our faculty, our staff, just really fantastic effort, and I'm so proud. And this is what makes Long Beach City College the jewel that it is in the city. And, you know, we're not done. We still have a month before commencement, and we're so excited about the plans that we have for you. We definitely plan on honoring you. We plan on honoring your hard work. We plan on honoring your families, all the sacrifices that you've made. And I think you'll be very excited. We've had to make some really tough decisions. We've had to make some tough choices, but we have done everything with students in mind. We have truly made the effort to make our decisions student-centered. What would students like? We've taken input. And just like this town hall today, all the questions that we received, each vice president and each staff member will address each question specifically, and hopefully you will come away from this 1 hour town hall feeling much better about the plans that we have for you. I also want to let you know that the information that's being provided here today are questions that we took from students in the community. And if you would like, there's still a way that you can email or get in touch with us. Just in case we have time at the end of this town hall, we'd love to pick up any other questions that we have. So thank you all again for tuning in. We're here for you, and hopefully this town hall is as productive for you as we hope that it is. Thank you all. Hope you're safe and hope you're well.
Thank you, President Malauulu. Before we start the town hall today, I want to just make a couple of comments about, I know, questions that are in all of your minds. I want to tell all of our Long Beach students that you are not alone. You have hundreds of faculty and staff here at the college that are here to help you. And if you need that help, you must please reach out to them. Students have been doing that. They've been getting some of their questions answered, some of their fears allayed, but it's very important that you reach out to faculty and staff and all of us here on this panel today to be able to help you. I know you have some questions about the fall semester. Here's the latest news on that. We announced last week that we were going to be going online in the fall with very limited face-to-face participation in a few courses. We will have a list of those courses up shortly, and you'll be able to see which courses, and we'll have more information about how to access those courses and how to go through the registration process. Long Beach has moved our priority registration from a prior date to June 1st through June 12th for priority registration. It'll be open to all students on June 15th. With the decision regarding the fall semester, most students will not be returning to campus in the fall. But as I said, we will have some limited face-to-face instruction with more information coming about that. Also, regarding our virtual commencement ceremony, I know it's disappointing for a lot of you not to be able to do this in person. It's disappointing for us, but I think we will put together the best ever virtual commencement ceremony. We have a committee working on this at the college. We have some surprises and some good planning going on. It'll take place Friday, June 12th at 5 o'clock. And it'll be up after that if you want to stream that as well and take a look at it afterwards. But we know how important that is, and we also want you to know that you're welcome, and we would love to have you come back and walk in person in 2021. We know that change can be difficult, but please know that
I can go ahead and step in at this point if that would be appropriate. And our president, President Bynum, can certainly finish when she's resolved these issues. So I'll go ahead. My name is Dr. Kathy Scott, and I'm the Executive Vice President of Academic Affairs. It is my great pleasure, firstly, to be here with President Bynum and Board President Malauulu and my colleague, Dr. Munoz. He and I work very closely together because I'm on the academic side and he's on the student services side, and we collaborate on a daily basis. So in my area, though, I have amazing deans and classified staff, department heads, and hundreds of faculty, as President Bynum said. And our faculty are both full-time and adjunct, and they, like you, are working very, very hard to help our students finish this unprecedented semester. I'd like to echo what our president said. We admire our students who are continuing on as best they can, even though many have lost jobs, have financial worries, including struggles for many with food, housing. Many are taking care of young children or other family members. And we know too that many students are having issues with limited technology. Many don't have a laptop. Some have internet access issues. Many of our students, and even perhaps most of our students, don't necessarily have a quiet place to work. We know all this, and that makes us admire you and your efforts even more. All of us, as everybody else has said, will do everything we can to support you. So let me give you a few updates from the academic area. Firstly, the spring suspended classes. First, I'd like to clarify that no semester-long spring classes were canceled. The only canceled classes were some of the late start 8 week that could not be taught online and had not even started yet. These were some classes mainly in the trades area, but we do still have 80 suspended classes. Some are in the health sciences, some are in CTE or the trades, and it is our plan to bring students back for those classes as soon as we are allowed to do so. And we want students to be able to complete those classes. If they choose to do so, students can take an incomplete and finish them over the summer, as we're hoping to do. Students also have the option of taking an EW, the excused withdrawal, and retaking the class in the fall. We are working on safety protocols for those suspended programs when they return. Faculty and students will need to wear masks. We will be cleaning equipment, workspaces, and nearby restrooms throughout the day, and we will be engaging in social distancing. For each program, plans are being created for how to engage in these practices for that particular program within that particular lab space. And this information will be communicated to faculty and students. And for summer, we've already reported that summer would be online, and we are not offering any face-to-face courses in summer, with the exception of trying to bring back those suspended classes. For fall, we will be mostly online, as President Bynum said. We are currently making changes to the fall schedule, most of which will be done before June 1st. We would encourage students, however, of course, to register at the appropriate time, but to please continue checking the fall schedule, as additional classes will be added during the month of June. Changing such a large schedule with about 2,400 classes is a very, very big task, and faculty and staff are working overtime to get it done as quickly as possible. If there is a change to a class that you've enrolled in after registration starts, you will be contacted. So please be sure that we have your correct phone number and your email address in the Viking portal. In the schedule of classes, each class, as you know, has a class number. When you click on that class number for fall, you will be able to see if the class is going to be offered asynchronously, synchronously, or a combination. We understand that these terms are often difficult to remember. They're kind of long and complicated for all of us. But it's good to get to know what they mean. And I'll just cover them again very briefly. Asynchronous means that instructors prepare their course materials and students access the course at their chosen time. This type of class is typical of a standard online class. Synchronous is when instructors and students gather in real-time virtual environments with regularly scheduled days and times, as they would in a regular college campus class. And then the third is a combination of those two, where instructors will use a combination of real-time meetings and online work that students can access at their chosen time. And as President Bynum said, it is our intention to offer labs, some labs, face-to-face for fall. These are the ones that cannot be taught online. They include health sciences and some of the trades primarily. You will be able to see from the schedule after it's revised, what will be face-to-face and what will be online. In these types of classes, in these lab classes, they will have both lecture and lab. The lecture portion will be online and the lab portion will be face-to-face. For fall, we're trying to provide students with a variety of options. We understand that some of you like the synchronous options where you can be real time with your classmates. And we understand that some of you would prefer to do asynchronous so that you can do it on your own time. We know, and like I said, we know that many of you do not have a quiet space, and we would encourage you to work with your counselors to select the classes that are best for you. And I'll echo again what President Bynum said. We absolutely want our students to keep going with their studies this semester and fall. This health situation will not go on forever. And we want students to be prepared for jobs and good careers so that they can have better lives and support their families. And staying in school is the best way to accomplish that. Thank you. And I will turn this over to my colleague, Dr. Munoz.
Thank you, Dr. Scott. Well, hello, Vikings. My name is Dr. Mike Munoz, and I have the great privilege of serving as the Vice President of Student Services. Like my colleague, Dr. Scott, and our Superintendent President Bynum, and our Board President Malulu, I just want to really extend how proud we are and express how proud we are of all of you as students. What you have been facing as students and overcoming as students is truly exceptional. We know how hard you all are working to stay current and up to date in all your classes in the midst of, you know, a lot of uncertainty, right? And so we are just so appreciative and so proud of all of you. And so I just want to start with that. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to just take a little bit of time and share with you ways that in student services, we are really working hard to continue to serve all of you and really try to meet student needs in the midst of COVID-19. So I'm going to start first with our counseling services. Some of the things that we've been able to do. One of the things that we've been able to do is really continue to serve students through what's called Cranium Cafe, through virtual counseling appointments. We launched a new chat feature, which is called Chat with Our Front Desk, that really kind of replicates the experience where students used to be able to walk into the counseling center or, or, or enter the counseling center and talk to someone at the front desk and ask a quick question, well, you now can do that through Cranium Cafe and by accessing the feature called Chat with Our Front Desk. Also, just in the month of April, to give you a sense, over 1,100 students have met with counselors through virtual counseling appointments. So we really aren't seeing a large decrease in the number of students we are seeing when we compare the number of students we're seeing in counseling appointments through our virtual counseling appointments compared to our in-person counseling appointments. And so that's really important because what that means is students are able to access a counselor to get assistance with course selection, to ask questions about pass, no pass, or their excused withdrawal options, or build an educational plan. So again, if you're a student that's saying, you know what, I feel like I need some extra support, you know, registration's around the corner, I need help picking my classes, or actually I just need to talk to someone about some of the things that I'm experiencing in terms of how to balance my schoolwork with everything that's going on right now, schedule an appointment with one of our counselors. And you can access our counseling grid through the counseling website, also through the COVID-19 website, as well as the counseling website. So again, I strongly encourage you to meet with a counselor. In the area of financial aid, this is really important. We recognize that many of our students have lost wages during the time of COVID-19, and so really quick access to financial aid matters. And so I'm very proud to share with you that just since March 18th, when we went remotely, we have already reviewed over 2,600 financial aid files for students. So again, the process for reviewing financial aid applications is moving forward, and we're not missing a beat in this time of COVID-19. And as far as the CARES Act, you may have heard of the CARES Act and some things that were and ways that we're supporting students with what's called student emergency aid grants. So I'm going to talk a little bit about that. As of today, we have already disbursed over $1 million in student emergency aid to over 2,000 students here at Long Beach City College. And we're very proud of that. We are one of the community colleges that are leading the pack in the state for meeting students' emergency aid grant needs. And so we're very proud of that. As well as we've been really sensitive to think about what it looks like to support our dreamers. Because we know that our dreamers may not be able to fully access some of the federal financial aid programs. We are continuing to support our dreamers with student emergency aid grant applications through our California Student Equity and Achievement Program funding. So again, whether you're eligible for FAFSA or you're eligible for the California Dream Act, we're supporting you with the emergency student aid application that you can access through the Viking portal. Also, I want to share with you that we've identified an additional 5,500 students here at Long Beach City College that meet the eligibility to receive an additional $500 emergency student aid grant through the CARES Act. And so make sure you check your portal because we'll be sending you information about how to access those funds. In the area of student health services, the Student Health Center has been deeply committed to continue to provide services to students in the midst of COVID-19 and in this pandemic. And they've been available through telehealth, phone call conversations with students, Skype, as well as through Cranium Cafe. They also have been able to provide support in a wide range of workshop topics on that, such as anxiety, stress management, smoking cessation, as well as suicide prevention. So, again, we have been working really hard to make sure that our students have access to their health services, as well as any type of mental health support that they might need in the midst of this pandemic. And lastly, the two other items I want to share with you is how we're committed to serving students and that need support through our Viking Vault and our laptop loan program. So I'm very proud to share with you that we have distributed over 1,300 bags of groceries to students since moving to remote instruction and services. And that's quite significant. And these bags are very robust. They are bags filled with food that is designed to get a student through the week. So there's tuna, peanut butter, bread, all sorts of highly nutritious foods, again, that's intended to really help sustain a student for at least a week. And so we've been very successful in providing our grab-and-go grocery bag distribution, both at LAC and PCC. Another way that we've been really supporting our students' basic needs is with our laptop loan program. So students who may not have access to a laptop, and we know you know, maybe you have a laptop, but it's used by multiple people in the family. So that creates kind of a usership kind of competition. I know sometimes me and my daughter, we have one laptop and we're competing for who gets to use the laptop when. So if you're in that situation, we want to encourage you to apply for our laptop loan program. We have almost 900 laptops ready for distribution for students who are in need that would need access to a Chromebook or laptop to support them being successful in their classes. So again, we just want to let you know, Vikings, that we are extremely proud of you. We're here to support you. And with that said, I'll turn it back over to our president, Superintendent Luann Bynum, to ask all the questions that have been sent forwarded. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Munoz, and thank you, Dr. Scott. This is the part that I'm sure you've all been waiting for. We received a lot of questions. We won't be able to answer all of them, unfortunately, but we will be posting questions as a follow-up to this so you can get answers to your questions as well. I just want to let you know also that website will have questions. Some of you wondered, someone asked me, where are the questions from the last town hall? Those will be up again as soon. We just want to make sure that we're doing it correctly and not duplicating stuff. Okay, let's start off. I think I'm going to toss this one to Dr. Scott. There's actually two questions that are kind of similar here, Dr. Scott. It has to do with vocational nursing 215. Will students be able to take this for the fall? And if you can give an update on when the clinical rotations from spring semester might resume. I'm sure that others can relate in that my income is dependent on completing the class and becoming a licensed nursing assistant.
Thank you, President Bynum. All right, VN 215 is our certified nursing assistant course. It requires 8 weeks of classwork and 80 hours to be performed in a health facility, typically nursing homes. We will be accepting students and can complete the first 8 week portion. But given how seriously and tragically people in nursing homes have been impacted by the virus, we will have to wait and see when we can return to those facilities, you know, when it is safe for students and faculty and patients. So students again can start the course, but there may be a delay in completing those 80 hours, which are required. And there's obviously limited control that we have over that. And in regards to the second one, we want our students out there in the workforce. We know how badly they're needed. As soon as we can possibly finish the spring semester, we will do so. And then getting the next group in, we'll certainly do that as quickly as we can as well. So we want our students to earn a living. We understand how much people want to get out there and help. And thank you very much. That was a great question. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Scott. Dr. Munoz, there's two here that are similar as well. I'm going to put them together. For those that drop their courses due to financial stress and changes due to the pandemic, what is the process to obtain a refund? And will we get refunded for the parking permit?
Great. Thank you, President Bynum. Mm-hmm. So let's talk a little bit about the process for refunds as well as parking. So we work really hard to make this process for refunds an automatic process. So there's a couple key points I want to make. First, refunds are eligible for students who are not currently receiving financial aid. So that means if you paid out of pocket for your tuition or any of your fees, once you withdraw with an excused withdrawal, there's a process that will automatically process a refund that will be sent to you. And so if there is additional information on the COVID-19 student website that explains that process for refund, but there isn't anything that you will need to do to trigger that refund. Simply by dropping your course through an excuse withdrawal process will automatically trigger that refund process. As far as parking, we will be refunding student parking at a 60% prorated rate. So what does that mean? That means you will receive roughly 60% of what you paid for the parking permit in a refund. And again, that process is automated as well. You will not have to initiate anything. We will just simply send you that refund through our refund process.
Great, thank you. That was very helpful, I'm sure, for the students. Dr. Scott, I'm going to combine these two also because they're quite similar. I'm a studio arts major and I have my stuff in my art locker at LAC. I think that if we leave our stuff until after the semester ends, then all of our art stuff will be removed and thrown away. However, due to the immediate response of LBCC shutting down, can you hold on to our stuff until we can get it? And then the other question is closely related. I left my stuff in my gym locker and then the school shut down. Will I be able to get my items back, or are they just going to be cleaned out?
Okay, it is not our intention to clean out people's belongings. art students with their things in art lockers should contact their faculty member and request access to the locker. We will be granting that access. The faculty member will work with their dean to schedule a time for students to come in one at a time with masks, with social distancing, to get their belongings. And we would like to schedule this on a day when numerous students can come in at staggered times. That makes it easier on our facilities staff, which is very busy right now, trying to accommodate city health officials, services, and faculty and staff who are also trying to get onto the campus. If students do not contact us, we will reach out to them, assuming we have the correct contact information for you. And it is our intention and hope to be able to return belongings to all of our students. We're not intending to throw it away. And in regards to gym locker, it's basically the same answer. Please work with your faculty member and request access to your gym locker. And we will, just like with art, we will schedule time so people come in staggered over a day or two and get their things. And if we have to do it over multiple days, we can do that also. Thank you.
Thank you. This is for Dr. Munoz, and it's actually having to do with counseling. And two questions also, but I'm going to combine them. How would we go about meeting with a counselor to discuss classes needed to stay on track? How do I contact my counselor in order to get my classes for fall semester and grading policy for my transfer degree?
Thank you, President Bynum. Mm-hmm. So at the start of the transition to remote student services, we launched a remote student services micro website that can be accessed from our COVID-19 page. So what I would do is I would ask students to click on the COVID-19 website, micro website, then on the student link, and then click on counseling. From there, you will be directed to a link, and no, it sounds like a lot of link clicks, but it's really not. It's really two simple clicks. You'll be directed to the counseling website that will allow you to schedule an appointment with a counselor. And online, a virtual appointment, as well as if you have limitations to accessing technology that facilitates that virtual appointment, there's a number where someone can call you and have a phone appointment as well. So we're really trying to be thoughtful about the best way to support and reach our students. But I strongly encourage you to take advantage of that virtual face-to-face through the website interaction, because you would be able to also work with a counselor to select your courses, as well as discuss any potential implications for you and your transfer should you select to take an excused withdrawal or a pass no pass option. So those are the counselors are the best folks to discuss those items with. And so again, clicking on the COVID-19 student website, clicking on the counseling website will lead you right to making an appointment with a counselor.
Thank you. And I'm going to follow up again with you, Dr. Munoz. One student submitted a question. I was wondering if it is still possible to change your class to pass or no pass. Also, would it affect our SAP? Would I lose my priority registration due to changing it?
Thank you. So I'm going to make sure I'm writing down all these key parts to the question so that I respond to all parts. So let's talk a little bit about changing your class, right? Or changing your options. So we've extended the deadline for pass, no pass, and excuse withdrawal to May 27th. And we did that so that students have an opportunity to stay enrolled in the course as long as possible before making any final decisions about what's the best next step for them. Because we really want you to stay in class and we really want you to try to complete the course. So let's talk about how this affects satisfactory academic progress, because that's what that means when we say SAP, and that's related to financial aid, as well as pass, no pass, and priority registration. So based on federal guidelines that we receive from the U.S. Department of Education, this particular term, because we are in a state of emergency, national emergency, will not affect you in terms of your satisfactory academic progress, either towards your GPA progress or your progress towards the units you are taking. So if you do select a pass-no-pass option, or you do select an excused withdrawal, for the purposes of financial aid, for the purposes of federal financial aid, this term will not impact you. Now, in terms of your transfer though, the pass, no pass should not affect you if you're transferring to a Cal State University. However, for the University of California system, the pass, no pass, in terms of how it will be received varies by the UC campus. So we would really want you to sit down and meet with a counselor to review both your educational goal, your major, and your transfer institution destination to really determine what is the best option for you in regards to pass, no pass. But again, for the purposes of financial aid, excuse withdrawal and pass, no pass should have no effect on you. As far as priority registration, an excuse withdrawal or a pass, no pass should not affect you as well either. Our priority registration at Long Beach City College is established locally, and we understand that we are in the midst of a pandemic, and so we will not be using any of your academic standing this semester to impact your priority registration here at Long Beach City College.
Thank you. This is for Dr. Scott. Will science courses with laboratory sections still be awarded as a lab course given the current situation of remote instruction this spring semester?
Thank you, President Bynum. Yes, they absolutely will count as regular lab credit. Our science faculty have been working diligently to ensure that lab courses in an online environment are covering the necessary components to give students credit for these courses and to help them prepare for fields such as nursing. The CSUs and UCs have indicated that they will be accepting our online lab courses. For your institutions, their own lab courses are also online, and we are monitoring them to see how they are transitioning to online instruction. And we are working carefully to make sure that we meet the requirements of our four-year partners. We are also working to ensure that the instruction needed for our nursing students meets the needs of students going into those fields. In other words, the same student learning outcomes will be met, just done in a different modality. Thank you.
Great, thank you. Now here's one about books for Dr. Scott. What do we do about books that we rented? Can we go to the school and return them?
Thank you, President Bynum. Currently, right now, that is not an option. But Barnes & Noble is offering numerous services for students. Rental books may be shipped free to the bookstore. If you go to the bookstore's website, which is lbcc.bn.college.com, there is a link where you can print a free return shipping label. Books will be able to be returned to the store once we resume normal operations. We just don't know exactly when that will be yet. But no late fees will be applied, so you don't have to worry about that. If you want to just hang on to them and return them later, you're free to do so. For summer and fall classes, Barnes & Noble is offering curbside pickup for books ordered through them. Again, information can be found on that website that I listed previously. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Dr. Munoz, due to the coronavirus, I am unable to pay for my classes. I don't want to get dropped because I won't be able to pay them. Is it possible for me to still keep my classes?
Thank you, President Bynum. So for our students who are concerned about how they're going to pay for their classes, I strongly urge them, one, to submit a FAFSA if they're eligible. And if they're not eligible to submit a FAFSA, maybe they're eligible to submit a California Dream Act. And if they're not eligible to submit a California Dream Act, I strongly encourage them to submit an emergency student aid application. We are providing students with $500 support through the emergency student aid application, if they've experienced some form of loss of income or impact by COVID-19. And so those $500 that the student could receive could be used to pay those fees. And the emergency student aid fund is not contingent upon you qualifying for the FAFSA or California Dream Act. So we have funds for students who are receiving federal Pell dollars. We have funds for students who are receiving the California Dream Act. And we also have emergency aid fund for students who, let's say maybe when they applied for the FAFSA, their parents were making too much money, or maybe they were making too much money themselves. But as a result of COVID-19, there's been a drop in their income. And so they've lost wages. And so this would make them qualify for our emergency student aid application. So that is what I recommend students to do who might be concerned about how they're going to pay for their classes. And lastly, I will say, if you're a student who's really concerned about how you're going to pay for classes and you've exhausted all of these options, you can contact our student equity office, and one of our case managers in the student equity office will try to work with you as best as they can, because we recognize every student's unique and every situation is unique. So we will put a very high touch approach to helping you find a way to keep you in school.
Great, thank you. And we'll follow up with another question for you, Dr. Munoz. For students that are borrowing laptops due to limitations on having technology resources, when they graduate or transfer, can they return it back before the semester ends, or can they bring it back later or next year?
Excellent question. So laptops that were checked out for the semester are for the duration of the semester. So if you're a student who is graduating or who does not plan on re-enrolling for summer or fall, we're going to ask that you return that laptop. And since we have student agreements that have been completed, we will contact all the students who are scheduled to return the laptop and inform them of the process for returning the laptop. We should have ways where that you can return the laptop both at PCC and at LAC campus so that it's as convenient as possible. But we are going to ask that you return that laptop. If you're a student that says, hey, you know what, I have this laptop for spring, but I'm going to have unmet needs still for summer and fall, then we're going to allow you to continue to hold on to that laptop as long as you maintain your enrollment for summer and for fall semester.
Great, thank you. This is Dr. Scott. I took a welding class in spring, and there were only a few weeks left. I have yet to receive my grade. Will I be getting a grade, or is this a course I'm going to have to read?
I'm advised, and I told her the ones I wanted to.
Thank you, President Bynum. I believe that I answered most of this question in the introduction, but let me just be clear. The welding classes were among those that were suspended because some hands-on time is required for students to be able to finish those classes. In some cases, it's a safety issue for the students to be able to have that hands-on time. So students who want to be given an incomplete and come back this summer to finish those courses will be allowed to do so, providing that we have the approval of public health officials to open up the campus for those classes. And then if students do complete their spring classes in summer, then they're able to take new classes in the fall, which is what we really would like, rather than students having to spend an entire semester retaking a class when they did most of the work already. So this is what we're hoping for. But students, if they are not comfortable coming back in summer to complete the classes, or they want, for whatever reason, to take the class again, they can do so. They just take the excuse withdrawal and enroll in the same class in the fall. It's the student's decision, and they, again, may want to talk to a counselor before they decide. It's important for students to understand generally that we cannot give grades in classes that have not been completed. We have obligations and commitments to our transfer institutions, such as the UCs and the CSUs, as well as to industries or companies that hire our students. They have to have assurance that our students have the skills and knowledge required for that, for higher level courses or for a particular career. And completion of the course is a requirement. So it could also affect our articulation, which is our agreement with our transfer institutions if we gave grades out before students completed. So I appreciate that question. It's one that I've gotten a number of times pertaining to many different types of classes, but this is how we have to operate, and we appreciate your understanding.
Thank you. Let me follow up, if I may, Dr. Scott, with a question about the electrical program. I want to enroll in the LBCC electrical program. How will online and physical distancing affect lab classes, which are the bulk of classes to be taken? You may have already answered this in part in other questions, but.
Okay, well, thank you. And I appreciate that because our electrical program is one of our premier programs, no question. Fortunately, many of the lab spaces for programs such as electrical are already quite large, and there is substantial space between students in the way that it exists now and the areas that students work in. However, we will be working on plans with faculty in the area, in that particular area, to ensure that safety protocols, including social distancing and masks, are maintained when the suspended classes return and the new classes in fall commence. It is possible also that we may rotate groups of lab students in on different days to keep the numbers low. This is part of what is being planned right now, and I actually think there's a meeting this afternoon with the faculty in these programs. And we will be doing everything we can to ensure that our students and our faculty are safe while also providing the hands-on instruction that is needed for students to learn proper techniques for things like working, you know, in an electrical setting. We have to ensure that people know what they're doing before they go into the workplace and they're not going to hurt themselves. The same goes for classes such as auto, you know, working with high voltage equipment. That's partly why the students really do have to come back and finish those classes. But we have very big spaces in many of these areas, and we don't think it will be too big of a problem. Thank you.
Great, thank you. Let me turn to Dr. Munoz now. This is a question about work study. If a work study student takes an early withdrawal from a class that will take them under 6 units, will they still be able to participate in the work study program during the spring and or summer semester?
Thank you. So let's talk about work study. So there's two forms of work study. There's federal work study, and then there's college funded work study. So I'm going to speak specifically about federal work study first, and then I'll talk about the college work study. So the excused withdrawal should not affect a student's ability to receive federal work study as long as they don't withdraw from all their courses. So there's a distinction, right? So if you're, let's say, enrolled in 4 courses and you decide to do an excused withdrawal for 2 of those courses, but you maintain your enrollment in 2 courses, you should be able to continue receiving federal work study. But if you withdraw from all your courses, then you are no longer eligible for that federal work study. So the key is you need to maintain some level of enrollment in your courses in order to be eligible for federal work study. So it's kind of a depends situation, right? So the excused withdrawal only affects you in your federal work study if you withdraw from all your courses. Now, for the college work study, it's also very similar. We have students who receive college-supported work study, either from the state through CalWORKs or just through Long Beach City College. And so at this moment, we are continuing to support our college-funded work study students as long as, again, they maintain some level of enrollment here at the college. So the key is, if you have a question, I encourage you to either meet with a counselor or reach out to the financial aid office and meet with a financial aid advisor to really review your circumstance to make sure that you have the best information you need to make any decisions that you need to make regarding your excused withdrawal processes.
Thank you. We'll follow up with another question. Dr. Munoz, has to do with work study. Allocations from the CARES Act, which was given to Long Beach City College in the amount of $14,663,000, with a minimum allocation of $7,331,000 to be awarded for emergency financial aid grants to students. These are the figures I found online. My question is, will any of these funds be awarded to the work study students who will no longer be working come June 2020?
Thank you for the question. So let's talk a little bit about what the CARES Act is and the emergency aid funds that are coming through the CARES Act. So correct, we are going to be distributing roughly $7.2 million to students over the next year. So it's not funds that are going to be distributed just in the spring term, but we're going to be distributing funds in spring, in summer, and fall, and even in potentially spring of 2021. So what that means is these funds are separate from federal work study students funding sources, but they're stackable. So you can be a federal work study student and be eligible for receiving support through the CARES Act. The way we've structured our support for students currently, at least for spring semester, now it may look different for summer and fall 2020, but for spring, all students who are Pell eligible or who are Pell recipients enrolled in at least 6 units will be eligible to receive a $500 emergency aid grant, which most of our work study students meet that criteria. So as long as you're a work study student who meets that criteria, meaning you received a Pell grant and you're enrolled in at least 6 units, you should expect to receive a $500 emergency aid grant. So again, these two pots of money are separate, right? They're two different types of forms of financial aid. One is federal work study. One is the financial aid emergency aid grants that are being allocated through the CARES Act. And so the short answer is yes, you should be eligible, but remember every student's financial aid package is unique. And so I wanna caution students to meet with a financial aid officer to get a full review of their financial aid package to make sure they're getting access to all the funds they're eligible for.
Great, thank you. Let's switch over to Dr. Scott. For those students who applied to the Associate Nursing Degree Program for fall 2020, are they still accepting students? I applied and they are supposed to email us in June if we were accepted or not. Due to COVID-19, are they accepting a new group of students?
Thank you. Great question. Yes, absolutely. We plan on admitting a new cohort of students into the nursing program for fall. Notifications, which typically would go out in June, may be slightly delayed. And if you don't hear immediately, I wouldn't worry. It may take until approximately July 1st, because we're trying to complete the students from spring whose classes were suspended. But yes, we very, very much look forward to a new group of students. The nursing program, like so many of our other programs, is definitely one of our premier programs. And given how badly nurses are needed right now, we are absolutely gonna go forward. So thank you for that amazing question. And I appreciate being able to say that. Our faculty this semester have been very, very innovative and have been going way above to help our students finish. It's nice that they're able to use telehealth and some other different types of experiences. I should even say that I'm very proud of our students who are out there at LSC and PCC helping with, as volunteers, the testing sites. And they're getting some of their clinical hours right now for that. And our nursing faculty are out there with them. So congratulations to them for volunteering and being part of the solution here. And similarly, we have some of our students out in homeless shelters right now doing their mental health clinicals. And again, we're as volunteers, and we're very appreciative for those efforts as well. Thank you.
That's terrific. Thank you. Let's do another follow-up question, Dr. Scott. I am currently enrolled in AH 220 phlebotomy. We are doing the lecture portion through Zoom, and I would like to know when we can take the lab portion.
Okay, thank you. This is a similar response to other questions involving the health sciences mm-hmm. program. The phlebotomy program requires 40 clinical hours, and we need to be able to get into the hospitals to be able to provide this experience for students, and they have to complete this requirement. It's not optional, as the students in this program know. But the good news is that the hospitals are starting to contact us again about returning to clinicals. So as soon as we are able to do so, and as soon as it is safe for, again, our students, our faculty, and patients, we will be in there, and we are anxious for our students to finish. We know that they're anxious. We're anxious too. And as soon as we can, we will provide that opportunity.
Thank you. And I'll stay with you, Dr. Scott, for another question. I am a freshman and am interested in short-term one-month classes. I would like the opportunity to complete courses more quickly.
That was a very interesting question. And people do want to finish quickly. Our regular terms, which are fall and spring, are scheduled for 16 weeks. And it may sound like a long time, but that's actually a compressed calendar. Many of the colleges have 17 and a half or 18 week semesters. However, even though those are our primary terms, we do have some short-term classes within our primary terms. They might be 8 week, they could be 4 week. Many of the 4 week are typically tend to be in the career tech education area, such as our forklift training. But that's the semester system is pretty much how the colleges in our system work. And it's established, you know, for the California Community Colleges, and we have to sort of abide by their rules. But I should note, and I do want to note, that we do have shorter term classes in summer and in winter. Summer has 2 5-week back-to-back sessions. And it's not a little bit more than a month, but it's still pretty short. And we also in summer have a 6-week option and an 8-week option. We feel that we have something for everybody. And our winter intercession is also 5 weeks. So we do have those built in between our regular terms. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Munoz, since commencement has been postponed to 2021, with virtual commencement instead this year, can the class of 2020 still purchase their 2020 tassel, cap, gown, et cetera, if they don't want to walk next year, or if they're transferring to a CSU, UC, or private college in the fall of 2020?
Thank you. That's an excellent question. And so yes, students are still able to purchase their regalia for the virtual ceremony, whether you participate or not. And in fact, one of the things that we're going to be doing, because we know what a huge accomplishment this is for our students and for our families and for our community. We will be providing grad packages for students who are interested in participating in the virtual ceremony. And so more information will be coming about how students can obtain a free grad package for those that participate. There will be a limited supply, so students will have to sign up for them. But we will be providing some support to students through a grad package, a gift, right, from Long Beach City College with some Viking swag, and just to kind of just say, you know, we're proud of you, right? As well as you'll have the opportunity, should you want to return in 2021 and walk through the commencement ceremony as part of 2021. And so, yes, you'll be able to visit the bookstore's website and order your regalia.
Thank you. Okay, let's see. We've got a number of other questions here. I'm going to combine these two for Dr. Munoz. If I haven't received my financial aid disbursement yet, what do I do? I've contacted the financial aid office already. It's been over a week now and I still haven't received anything. Then the next question is, when will the 2021 loan application be available?
Okay, so a couple questions. Let's talk about this. So for financial aid, what I strongly encourage students to do is to, again, visit the COVID-19 micro student website and click on the financial aid department. You have the ability to send an email, as well as folks will be answering the phone calls through financial aid that are coming in during normal business hours. So I would strongly encourage students to try calling into the financial aid office first, or sending a direct message through the financial aid website. If students have not been able to receive information, let's say they, like this particular student says, you know, I've called, I haven't been able to reach the financial aid office, then what we would do is I would ask you to then reach out to one of our financial aid supervisors, and their contact information is available as well on the website. And usually an email to supervisors, our supervisors and financial aid are pretty responsive. They should definitely get on that case and respond to it. As far as the loan application, we are currently in the process of setting up all of the financial aid terms for the next school year, which is the 2021 school year. And we actually have been processing, I'm going to get a little financial aid techie here. We've been processing ICERS and processing already those files for packaging for next year. So students should be checked. I encourage students to check their Viking portal to see if there are any updates from financial aid, because that's where they're going to get the most up-to-date information on their financial aid application file.
Thank you. And Dr. Scott, here's another question. If you make us come back in the fall to face-to-face classes on campus, will you make optional arrangements for students who, for health reasons, do not want to step foot on campus yet?
That's an interesting question, thank you. Like I said earlier, most of our fall classes are going to be online, and we're not going to make anybody come onto campus. If students want to take a welding class or an electrical class or an advanced transportation class, it will have a face-to-face lab component, because there's no other way for students to complete those courses without it. So if you feel that you do not want to come face-to-face and you don't want to take those classes, then you may want to hold off until spring. And you may want to contact the faculty member and get some reassurance that you will be safe with the social distancing and the very large lab spaces that we have. I mean, of course, we can't guarantee anything, but we're going to make it as safe as it can be. but we're not going to make anybody come onto campus. It is completely at their option. And you may want to take this time to take GE classes and hold off on the lab classes if you don't want to come in. That would be my advice.
Thank you. Another question. We've got a couple of minutes here. Another question for Dr. Munoz. Why are international students denied resources from the LBCC Student Emergency Fund? Are there any resources for international students?
Thank you, President Bynum. So based on the guidelines that we have received from the U.S. Department of Education, only students who are eligible to apply for federal financial aid are able to receive those emergency aid grant funds. And so unfortunately, our international students are not eligible to apply for those CARE Act dollars. However, I would like to let our international students know that there's other ways that we're looking to support and help them. So our international students can also apply for other forms of support from the college, such as our laptop program. If they're struggling with food insecurities, they can also visit our Viking Vault grab and go grocery bag distribution. So we are supporting international students through those supports. If international students are dealing with transportation issues, they can apply for our Strong Beach bus pass program with Long Beach Transit, and we will provide them with access to that bus pass. So although we're not able to provide our international students with direct financial aid through the emergency aid grant funds that are available through the CARES Act, we are trying to find ways, creative ways, to support our international students in other ways.
Thank you very much. Well, thank you, everybody. We didn't get to all the questions, but we will be putting the questions that have not been answered online so students get a chance to be able to have an answer for those too. Before I close, President Malauulu, do you want to say a couple of words?
Truly, I appreciate that. I do. I just wanted to let everybody know on this panel, thank you very much for tuning in. I also would like to extend my sincerest gratitude to our technology team, our remote learning instructors, everybody behind the scenes. We've got some very enthusiastic sign language interpreters who have been with us this past hour, very grateful for their service. Also, just the fact that we had so many students tuning in live right now, I'm actually checking on the website and we had lots of people tuning in. That just goes to show that Vikings can handle anything. We can handle any situation, and our students truly have inspired me personally. I've been working from home and going into the office, and I can only imagine what our students are having to go through. We've done everything we could to maintain a continuity of services for instruction and student support, and just, you know, hang in there. We know that this is challenging. We know that it's difficult. Some of you have, as was mentioned earlier, lost sources of income, sources of childcare. We are here for you. Please reach out. You can reach out to us personally, email, log on to our website, lbcc.edu. You are not that which doesn't break us, makes us stronger, and you are all the best. Thank you, Superintendent President Luann Bynum. Thank you, Executive Vice President Dr. Kathy Scott. Thank you, Vice President of Student Services Dr. Mike Munoz. Hang in there and go Vikings.
That's right. Thank you, President Malauulu. Thank you very much to everybody today and to our technical team and our interpreters. We really appreciate the work you're doing for us. And to the students, stick with us. We're here for you. We're not going anyplace, and we want you to continue. And to the community, don't forget that you too can have access to online classes to help you if you're making any kind of a transition from a job, or if you've lost a job and you need to upgrade some skills. Please go on our website and get that information. Again, everybody have a safe, healthy day and stay Viking strong.